Design of coupled line couplers. In the previous video, we have presented a brief introduction about coupled lines. Now, in this video, we are going to discuss how to design a coupled line coupler by using coupled lines. The general configuration of coupled line coupler is based on a coupled line transmission line with a fixed length. This fixed length will correspond to a phase shift equals theta, and this coupled line transmission line will have even and odd impedance Z not even and Z not odd. This coupled line section has four ports, 1, 2, 3, 4. These four ports will be connected to a conventional transmission line sections. So we have four ports here: port number 1, port number 2, port number 3, and port number 4. And these ports are assumed to have a characteristic impedance Z naught. So in this case, if we have the excitation from port 1 with an amplitude TV naught, and the other three ports are connected to matched load, so the equivalent circuit in this case would be 2V naught connected to Z naught, which corresponds to the characteristic impedance of port 1, connected to the coupled line transmission line, and the other ports are connected to Z naught connected to the ground plane. This is the equivalent circuit in this case. To determine the coupling coefficient and the directivity of such coupled line transmission line or coupled line direction coupler, the through will be to port 2. So the value of V2 over V1 correspond to the through power, and the coupled signal will be coupled to port 3. So the coupling coefficient would be V3 over V1, and the directivity or the isolated port, it would be port 4. This means that the directivity, it would be the value of the power at port 4 to the value at the power of port 3 when excited from port 1. This means that it is required to determine the values of V1, V2, V3, and V4 when the excitation voltage here is 2V0, and from these volts we are going to determine the coupling coefficient, the through power transfer, and the directivity of this direction coupler. This is our plan for the analysis of this coupled line direction coupler. Actually, the analysis of the coupled line direction coupler is similar to the power divider, the Wilkins power divider. It can be represented in even and odd modes. In the even mode, the two coupled lines will be excited by voltage sources V0 with the same polarity at port 1 and port 3. On the other hand, in the odd mode, the two ports will be excited by V0 and V0, but with reverse polarity. So this would be positive V0 and this would be negative V0, like this. This is the odd mode analysis. By adding the even mode plus the odd mode, the total voltage would be 2V0 at port 1 and 0 volt at port 3. So the summation of the even and odd mode will represent the actual problem, which is 2V0 here, and the remaining ports are connected to the ground plane. Okay. All right. In the even mode, we are using the even characteristic impedance of the coupled line transmission line, Z not even. And in this case, the coupled line circuit can be presented by a single circuit, assuming the lower circuit, for example, which have a transmission line with a characteristic impedance equal Z not even. This transmission line has a phase shift theta, and it is terminated by an impedance Z not, and it should be noted that Z not is different from Z not even. And this transmission line terminated by Z not is connected to a source with internal characteristic impedance Z not and internal voltage source V not. So the input impedance seen by the source here, the input impedance at this point, it will be the input impedance of a terminated transmission line section of characteristic impedance Z not and terminated by Z not even and terminated by a Z load equal Z not. So the input impedance in this case, Z input even for the even mode, it would be Z not even, the even characteristic impedance, the characteristic impedance of the line, multiplied by Z load, which is not note here, plus J Z not even tan theta over Z not even plus J Z not tan theta. This is the input impedance of a terminated transmission line. The characteristic impedance of the transmission line is Z not even, and the terminating load is Z not. This input impedance is connected to a source with internal impedance Z not and internal voltage V not. So the voltage at this point is simply obtained by using a voltage divider for V not multiplied by Z input over Z input plus Z not. So the voltage V1 at this point equals V not multiplied by Z input even over Z input even plus Z not, where Z input even is the input impedance seen here, which he has obtained like this. And the current passing through this terminal, which is I1 even, would equal V naught over Z input even plus Z naught, which is the internal impedance of the source. This helps to determine the voltage at port 1 and the current at port 1 for the even mode. In a similar way, for the odd mode, the voltage source at the port 1, it would be positive V naught, while the voltage source at port 3, it would be minus V naught, such that the current passing in the lower circuit would be in the negative direction with respect to the upper circuit. In this case, the odd circuit, we can study just the lower circuit, and by a similar way we can obtain the result from the upper, for the upper circuit with negative sign. In this case, the characteristic impedance of the transmission line is Z not odd. Similar to the even mode circuit, we are going to obtain the input impedance at port 1. So the input impedance in this case, which is Z input odd, it would equal the characteristic impedance Z not odd multiplied by Z not, which is the load impedance, plus J Z not odd tan theta over Z not odd plus J Z not tan theta. This is the input impedance at this point. From the input impedance at this point, we can obtain the input voltage at this point in the odd circuit. So V1 odd would be V0 multiplied by Z in odd over Z in odd plus Z0, which is simple potential divider. We have Z input odd connected to Z odd, and we are interested in the voltage at this point. So it is V0 multiplied by Z0, Z input odd over Z input odd plus Z0. And the current passing through the port 1 would be I1 odd, would equal I1 odd is V0 over Z in odd plus Z0. In this case, the voltage and the current at the port 3 would be the same value but with negative sign, because this is odd function or odd symmetry. Now we obtain the even voltage at terminal 1 and the odd voltage at terminal 2. The even voltage at terminal 1 and the odd voltage at terminal 1, 2. So now if we are interested to obtain the total voltage for the excitation with 2V0 at the coupled line circuit, it is simply to say that the input impedance of the total circuit would equal V1 over I1, which is V1 even plus V1 odd over I1 even plus I1 odd, because in the even circuit and the odd circuit, the voltage here is the same magnitude and in the same side. So by adding both of them, we are taking 2V0, and by adding V0 with minus V0 here, this would be 0. So we return back to the original circuit. So by adding these two circuits, the even and the odd, we can obtain the voltage at V1, V2, V3, and V4. So the total voltage here would be V1 even plus V1 odd, and the current, the total current would be I1 even plus I1 odd. And as we have already obtained the value of V1 even, it was V0 multiplied by Z im even over Z input even plus Z0. The current I1 even, it was V0 over Z input even plus Z0. In a similar way, V1 odd, it was V0 multiplied by Z input odd over Z input odd plus Z0. And I1 odd, it was V0 over Z input odd plus Z0. Now, by using these values, we can obtain the total input impedance, this plus this, over this plus this, which can be arranged as Z input odd multiplied by Z input even plus Z0, plus Z input even multiplied by Z input odd plus Z0 over Z input even plus Z input odd plus 2Z0. Actually, this is simple algebraic process. I'm sure that we can do it in a sheet of paper. Alright? By simplifying this, we can say that the input impedance is Z0 plus 2Z input even Z input odd minus Z0 squared over Z input even plus Z input odd plus 2Z0. Once again, the value of Z0 is the characteristic impedance of the transmission line connected to the boards of the coupled line. Alright? Z input even and Z input odd, Z input even and Z input odd are the input impedance seen at the port 1 for the even and odd modes. Alright, the question now is, if I'm interested in making the port 1 to be matching to the value of Z naught, this means that it is required to make this term to be 0. So, to obtain matched cable line, it is required to make this term equal 0. This term equals 0 by setting this value, Z input odd multiplied by Z input even equals Z naught square. Or in other words, Z naught equals square root of Z input odd multiplied by Z input even. So, to be matched, we are going to prove that this matching condition will be satisfied if the characteristic impedance of the feeding line Z naught equals the square root of the even characteristic impedance multiplied by the even odd impedance. So, let us assume that Z naught equals square root Z naught even multiplied by Z naught odd. And returning back to the value of Z input even it was Z naught even multiplied by Z naught plus G Z naught even tan theta over Z naught even plus G Z naught tan theta. Now we are going to replace Z naught by the square root of Z naught even Z naught odd. Right? Here and here. And dividing both the numerator and the denominator by the square root of Z naught even. So, in this case, the input impedance for the even mode would be Z naught even multiplied by square root of Z naught odd plus G Z naught even square root Z naught even tan theta over the square root naught Z naught even plus J square root Z naught odd tan theta. This has been done by replacing the value of Z naught by square root Z naught even Z naught odd here and here and dividing both the numerator and the denominator by the square root of Z naught even. In a similar way, Z input odd was originally as Z naught odd multiplied by Z naught plus G Z naught odd tan theta over Z naught odd plus G Z naught tan theta. Now we are going to replace Z naught by the square root of Z naught even Z naught odd here and here. Then by dividing both the numerator and the denominator by the square root of Z naught odd, we can prove that Z input odd is Z naught odd multiplied by the square root of Z naught even plus G square root Z naught odd tan theta over the square root Z naught odd plus G square root Z naught even tan theta. Now, we have Z input even and Z input odd in the case of Z naught equal square root Z naught even Z naught odd. Let us multiply this by this. Z input even multiplied by Z input odd. It would be Z naught even multiplied by Z naught odd, which is Z naught squared. And if we look at this term, we find that it is exactly the same as this term. On the other hand, if we look at this term, we find that it is exactly the same as this term. So, effectively, this fraction multiplied by this fraction would be unity. This means that, in this case, the value of Z input even multiplied by Z input odd would equal Z naught even multiplied by Z naught odd, which is actually, according to our assumption, is Z naught squared. So, If the value of z naught is the square root of z naught even multiplied by z naught odd, then the value of z input even multiplied by z input odd minus z naught square, it would be 0. This means that the input impedance, the total input impedance in this case, which was z naught plus 2 z input even minus z input odd minus z naught square, z input even multiplied by z input odd minus z naught square, this term would be 0. So in this case, the value of the input impedance, it would be z naught. Or in other words, the input impedance of this directional coupler will be matched for the feeding transmission line z naught. And in this case, if z input here equals z naught and the voltage is 2V naught in the original circuit, so the voltage V1, it would be V naught. Right? Okay. Now, we have obtained the voltage at the port 1. In similar steps, we can obtain the voltage at port 3. Actually, for port 3, in the even case, port 3, V3 even, is the same as V1 odd. But, V3 even is the same as V1 even. V3 even is the same as V1 even. But for the case of the odd circuit, V3 odd is minus V1 odd. V3 odd is minus V1 odd. So if we are going to say that the total voltage at the port 3, V3, is V3 even plus V3 odd, in terms of V1, it can be V1 even minus V1 odd, because V3 odd is minus V1 odd. So in this case, the voltage at the terminal 3, it can be obtained in terms of the even and odd modes at V3 even plus V3 odd. V3 even is the same as V1 even, but V3 odd is minus V1 odd. So V3 is V1 even minus V1 odd. And already we have proved that V1 even is V0 multiplied by Z input even over Z input even plus Z0. And V1 odd is V0 multiplied by Z input odd over Z input odd plus Z0. So by using these two values, we can say that V3 equals V0 multiplied by Z input even over Z input even plus Z naught minus Z input odd over Z input odd plus Z naught. And already we have proved that Z input even is Z naught even multiplied by Z naught plus J Z naught even tan theta over Z naught even plus J Z naught tan theta. In a similar way, Z input odd here Z input odd here I should use the original value. Z input odd, I should use this one. Z input odd is Z naught odd multiplied by Z naught plus J Z naught odd tan theta over Z naught odd plus J Z naught tan theta. So we have Z even and Z odd, not this one, the original one. From this, we can obtain the value of Z input even over Z input even plus Z naught by taking this. 1 over 1 plus Z naught, we can obtain this combination together as Z naught plus J Z naught even tan theta over 2 Z naught plus J Z naught even plus Z naught odd tan theta. And on the other hand, Z input odd over Z input odd plus Z naught can be obtained as z naught plus g z naught cot 10 theta over 2 z naught plus g z naught even plus z naught cot 10 theta. Actually, to obtain the form in terms of z naught even plus z naught cot like this, I should be using the final form after equating z naught equal square root z naught even plus z naught multiplied by z naught odd. Anyhow, you can check this point, please. Now we have this value and this value. From this, we are going to use this in this bracket, and by using these two values in this bracket, we can obtain the voltage at the terminal 3. So the voltage at the terminal 3 in this case would be V naught multiplied by G Z naught even minus Z naught odd 10 theta over 2 Z naught plus G Z naught even plus Z naught odd multiplied by 10 theta. This is the value of the voltage at the terminal 3. Actually, the coupling coefficient would be defined as the voltage at point 3 to the voltage at point 1. And the voltage at point 1 we have already proved to be V naught. Here, we said that the voltage at port 1 would be V naught. So, the coupling coefficient, it would be V3 over V naught, which would be this relation. Alright. It can be noted that it depends on the value of the even characteristic impedance and the value of the odd characteristic impedance and the value of the phase shift theta along the coupled line. For a special case, if the coupled line is lambda over 4, if it is lambda over 4 or quarter wave length, the value of theta it would be pi over 2. And in this case, the value of the tan theta would be nearly infinity or very large value. So, we can ignore the term 2z naught compared to the term multiplied by tan theta. And in this case, the coupling coefficient, which is V3 over V2, V3 over V naught, would be simply z naught even minus z naught odd over z naught even plus z naught odd. That actually what we are seeing here. Here is a voltage V3 as a function of V naught. For the case of theta equal pi over 2, or in other words, the length of the coupled transmission line is nearly lambda over 4. In this case, V3 over V naught would be z naught even minus z naught odd over z naught even plus z naught odd, which will be introduced as the coupling coefficient C. So the coupling here it would be from port 1 to port 3. Okay? For the general case, if theta does not equal pi over 2, we can organize this relation as by dividing both the numerator and the denominator by the bracket z naught even plus z naught odd. So we can say that V3 in the general case is V naught multiplied by JC 10 theta over the square root of 1 minus C squared, which is 2 z naught over z naught even plus z naught odd. This can be obtained as the square root of 1 minus c squared plus j 10 theta. In this case, the value of 1 minus c squared is 2 z naught over z naught even plus z naught odd. Okay. So, this is the coupling coefficient. Now we have two conditions. The first condition, the matching condition, when we are designing the coupled line coupler to be matched for a characteristic impedance z naught, then the z naught equals the square root of z naught even multiplied by z naught odd. The second condition is that the coupling coefficient c equals z naught even minus z naught odd over z naught even plus z naught odd. According to these two relations, we are going to design our coupler by determining the required value of the even characteristic impedance and the odd characteristic impedance. So, assuming that we are interested to design a coupled line direction coupler with to be connected with a transmission line of characteristic impedance 50 ohm, for example. So, Z naught is 50 ohm. And the coupling coefficient C, it would be 10 dB, for example, or minus 10 dB. So, the value of C is 0.1. So, we have the square root of Z naught even, Z naught odd is 50. And the value of Z naught even minus Z naught odd over Z naught even plus Z naught odd is 0.1. By solving these two equations in the two unknowns, Z naught even and Z naught odd, we are going to determine the even and odd characteristic impedance. From the even and odd characteristic impedance, we are going to determine the dimensions of the coupled line. Because as we have mentioned in the previous video, the even characteristic impedance and the odd characteristic impedance depends on the width of the strip, the spacing between the two strips, and the dielectric material. And it should be noted that the directional coupler in this case, or the coupled line section, should have a length of lambda over 4, such that the value of V3 over V0 would be the coupling coefficient directly. If it is not lambda over 4, so the value of V3 over V0 will not be exactly the value of coupling, or C. Alright? In a similar way, we can obtain the voltage at port 2 and the voltage at port 4. Port 2 here represents the through, and port 4 represents the isolated port. For the case of port 2, by adding the voltage, or the even voltage and the odd voltage at port 2, we can obtain it as V naught multiplied by square root 1 minus C squared over square root minus 1 minus C squared cosine theta plus G sine theta. For the case of theta equals pi over 2, this term cosine would be 0. This means that V2 over V1, V0 at theta equal pi over 2, it would be minus J square root 1 minus C squared. Minus J, it means that the phase shift between port 2 and port 1 is minus pi over 2, which corresponds to the phase shift theta. And the amplitude of V2 over V0 is square root 1 minus C squared. And remember that the voltage at the port 3, V3 over V0, it was C. This means that the power is divided between port 2 and port 3. The power at port 2, it would be 1 minus C squared, and the power at port 3 would be C squared. Finally, the voltage at port 4 is obtained by adding the even voltage at port 4 plus the odd voltage at port 4. And in this case, by adding them and calculating the total voltage, we can find it is V even minus V odd, which would be 0. This means that the port 1 does not transmit any power to port 4, or port 4 is the isolated port. It is interesting to note that this is the opposite case for the case of multi-hole or waveguide or hole coupled waveguide direction coupler. In hole coupled direction coupler, port 1 was coupling for this port. and this port with the isolated one. Now in the coupled line, transmission line, port 1 couple the power to this port, and the throat would be this port, and this port would be the isolated one. So it is interesting to note that there is a difference between whole cable direction coupler in the waveguide and cable line transmission coupler in the microstrip line and strip line by this difference. So the coupled port in this case is the nearby port for the feeding port. Alright, and as we said, the value of the coupling is Z not even minus Z not odd over Z not even plus Z not odd. If the value of theta is pi over 2, the voltage at the voltage 3 over the voltage V naught squared, it would be exactly C naught C squared, or the coupling squared. And the voltage at port 2 V2 over V naught squared, it would be exactly 1 minus C squared. But we should note that the coupling coefficient here is sinusoidally formed. So we are deviating from lambda over 4 or theta equal pi over 2. We can find that the coupling coefficient will be decreased and the power will be mainly going to the source. At the value of L or theta equals pi, which corresponds to lambda over 2, the total power will be passing to port 2, and both the port 3 and port 4 will be completely isolated. Okay, and this performance is periodically like this. Let us summary everything in design equation of coupled line direction coupler. For coupled line direction coupler, if the coupling coefficient is less than unity, C is less than unity, is a voltage coupling factor at the design frequency, and the design frequency corresponds to phase shift theta equal pi over 2, or physical length equal lambda guide over 4. So the design frequency corresponds to the frequency where the coupled line section would be lambda guide over 4. In this case, the input power at port 1 is half V naught squared over Z naught, and the power at port 2, it would be half V2 squared over Z naught, which is half 1 minus coupling squared multiplied by V naught squared over Z naught. And the power at port 3, it would be half the coupling coefficient squared multiplied by V naught squared over Z naught. And in the ideal directional coupler, the power at port 4, the isolated port, it would be 0. It can be noted that the input power is divided between port 2 and port 3, while port 4 is 0, so V input equal V2 plus V3, and V4 is 0. In this case, the characteristic impedance of the feeding transmission lines, Z0, should be the square root of Z0 even multiplied by Z0 odd, and the coupling coefficient, it would be Z0 even minus Z0 odd over Z0 even plus Z0 odd. From these two relations, we can calculate the even and odd characteristic impedance, the required even and odd characteristic impedance, as Z not even, it would be Z not multiplied by the square root of 1 plus C over 1 minus C, and Z not odd, it would be Z not multiplied by 1 minus C over 1 plus C. And it should be noted that in our design, the even characteristic impedance would be larger than the odd characteristic impedance. Finally, comments on coupled line coupler. In the above analysis, it was assumed that the even and odd mode coupled line structures have the same phase velocity. Actually, this condition is valid for the strip line, but it is not valid for microstrip line. So the line has the same electrical length for both modes. If it has the same phase velocity, the value of lambda, it would be the same. For current microstrobe line or other non-TEM mode, this condition will generally not be satisfied exactly. So, in this case, the phase velocity for the even mode is slightly different from the phase velocity for the odd mode. Or in other words, if I'm talking about lambda guide over 4, which lambda guide? The even or odd? So, we cannot exactly make the direction coupler to be lambda guide over 4. It is approximately lambda guide by 4. So, in this case, the coupler will not have exactly isolated board. So, we will have board directivity, or in other words, some power will be transmitted to the board 4. This type of coupler is best suited for weak coupling. If we are designing a coupled line coupler, it is suitable for the value of C is very small. If the value of C is great, it means that we are going to require the even and characteristic impedance, the difference between even and characteristic impedance, very large. And this very large varying between even and odd characteristic impedance, it can be obtained by very small s, or the separation between the coupled lines. This is not physically obtained. So this type of coupler is best suited for weak coupling, as large coupling factor requires lines that are too close together to be practical, or a combination of even and odd characteristic impedance that are non-realizable. So, generally speaking, coupled line direction coupler is mainly suitable for a small value of coupling coefficient C. In the following video, we are going to present a numerical example on how to design a coupled line direction coupler.